Hello, this is Shiva again and Jonathan, aka the Matrixers. And today's video is all about your questions about our last video, the Lighttrap in the Matrix. Many had many questions and there were also many reactions, many misunderstandings or what was not fully understood. Sure, once you've seen and experienced it, practically it is clear to us, but it was not clear to you. And that's why we thought we'd answer all your questions. That's why we're back today to answer your questions. Interestingly enough, the many reactions also raised many questions. We immediately collected around 40 questions from attentive and likable viewers. And so we thought we'd meet up today at Schloss Fernstein See. That's where we're sitting right now. Namely, this is a suite that Emperor Joseph I. sometimes booked to live there for a while and go for a walk by the lake. And the interesting thing about the room is that everything is still pretty dated. And we already had contact with a spirit on the first night. And we definitely have to show you the ceiling later, because the ceiling has been decorated in an artistic way and is a real feast for the eyes, in which you can really lose yourself. And you can take a look at that later. We'll show that from time to time. But we also met to have Shiva and I answer your 40 questions. 40 questions in one go, of course. It probably won't be quite possible, but we'll try to do half of it today. Yes, exactly. There may be a second part or a third part. Let's see how we do it. How do we manage that? Of course, as always, we do this on the fly. That means we don't have a script. We do it spontaneously. That's why things sometimes get a bit bumpy for both of us, because we haven't set up a teleprompter or any piece of paper here that we can read from. We always do it spontaneously on the spur of the moment, and that's why it can happen that we get a little stuck or maybe interrupt each other. You asked why we use the word Lighttrap, since that sounds very judgmental. But you shouldn't look at it that way. The word night, for example. If you just say it, it's just a word. That's unevaluated. A word, while it is a clear word, it has no dualistic charge. How good or bad? Only when you say, oh, the night is coming, is it judgmental. Or when you say, baby, the night is coming. It charges with an emotion. And the emotion is part of the matrix system. That's why you shouldn't judge it at all. Lighttrap. Of course, we wanted to trigger you a bit with it. We wanted to help you see what it's really like. We want people to wake up. We've been manipulated by the media for years, manipulated by the church for millennia, go into the light, etc. And that's why we use the word Lighttrap to inspire you to take a look. There might be something to it. In the end, of course, you don't have to believe us or anyone in this world. In the end, there is only one thing you should listen to, and that is yourself. You can trust yourself, your own feelings, your intuition. What we say, we have experienced in practice. There are some teachers who also mention this, like Castaneda or Ramtha. Of course, this is all just, we have practically experienced and experienced exactly what we are telling you in states or near-death experiences. And therefore, we don't want to tell you fairy tales here. We'll tell you the theory. We have seen it in practice. But what you have to do is experience exactly that. You have to go into those states, trust yourself, and then you can see what it's actually like. Follow your higher self, i.e., your intuition. If you think about it more closely, there is a certain logic to it. If you now imagine, after death comes this negative experience of death, this terror perhaps through an accident or through illness or through murder or something else. And then from this shock and fear you suddenly fly towards such a light that radiates beautifully and the like and that conveys the feeling of love. And I am God, or the feeling of God conveys that one faces God personally. Angels that may appear. You can see the polarity there. Angels, we already have angels, devils, demons, angels or the like, or beings of light and beings of darkness. You can already tell that we are dealing with a polarized or dualistic system have to do it. Exactly, and it is only the assessment, that of the duality, that charges the polarity. And what I would like to say about the beings of light, because everyone always thinks, oh, the beings of light are good and the dark beings and demons are the bad guys, they feed on our energies. No, no, you can't really say that. The beings of light also feed on us. I mean, what do beings of light feed on? High vibrating beings? Of high vibrating energy, of light, energy of soul energy. Practical. Now that shouldn't be seen as a negative thing. We also eat normally. And they feed themselves too. Of course, there are also systems that steal the energy. And that will be another video from us. But you shouldn't do it that way. You shouldn't judge it. For example, the Indian gods. These are high beings of light and they feed on high vibrational energy. All the gurus you see and with their thousands of followers. They gather separately. The followers don't know that, of course, but the beings of light, they collect all the energy from all the followers. They produce masses of energy and then suck it up. That's their diet. This is neither good nor bad. It's plain and simple. The gods, the high beings of light, also give people something in return. It's just a drop compared to what they're getting in terms of energy, but there's kind of a balance. And of course there are low vibrational beings, demons, ghosts, and they feed on other forms, demons of anger, emotions like fear and terror or what else is there. So, yes, now so much for that. It's not always, light is good, dark is evil. The important thing is what each one of you makes of it and what your decision is. I mean, there are also many people who absolutely want to go back into the light because they know that their loved ones who have died are in this light and don't want to leave them behind. So all of these motivations can of course have an influence on such a decision, and for this reason everyone has to know for themselves what they will do after death. But we, the matrixers, focus mostly on those trying to play the whole game of dualism and illusions and reality and non-reality and so on. To see through and perhaps find alternate ways to exit the matrix. I would say let's start with the question, or, yes gladly. Okay, so the first question we got was how exactly do you slip past the light? First of all, it would be important not to have any connection to earthly life. As long as you're attached to anything that's happening or is on earth, you can't get out of here. Be it your child or your parents. If you can't leave someone behind, then you can't go out. Or what would be another good example? Connection to anything. Yes, of course. So, when you're flying toward the light, it's also important. What's your intention? While moving towards the light? What do you want when you think of course somehow? I can't leave my child behind. This typical case, you also saw it in the wonderful and great series Westworld, in which one of the prisoners in the Western-style amusement park had just managed to leave the park, but then went back because she was going to Her child remembered and absolutely wanted to take the child back with him. What you have to be aware of. Nobody is really anybody's child. We are all the same old souls. We don't really leave anyone behind. And if so, then it was agreed beforehand at a higher level. Actually, you don't have to be afraid of leaving someone behind. But isn't that a reason to stay here? A second would, of course, be tempted. Of the perks of the Matrix, be it just camel riding or ice cream. Or ice cream or just. The Matrix offers many different possibilities. Thousands, millions of possibilities that you have there. And everyone comes into the Matrix with their wishes. I would like to experience it. I would like to experience that. So the range is huge. Only problem is stop. The more frequently or the more offers of the possibility of experiences are available, the more choice one has. The desire to come back is all the greater. And you can see it in the overpopulation. Those up there do a hell of a lot of advertising to be allowed to be here on Earth. And yes. And as you can see, more and more souls are coming, so they're piling up. And it's also a nice experience to be on Earth, to be able to touch something, to be able to test things and to be able to play. It's a big adventure. It's not like that. Only when you go up there you have to be aware, what do I want? I know this is a trap. She puts me in the cycle. I want that. I don't want that. If you don't want that, you really have to. You have to have a very strong, very clear will. No, I'm not going into the light and passing by. At least that's how I did it. Another important point in order to be able to slip past the light is, of course, that you have remembered your true self beforehand, that you have collected all your soul parts. They may actually have been scattered and trapped multidimensionally, on every level, astral, mental and beyond. Or on Earth. So collecting soul parts again mean that through the many lives you've lived, you might have 100,203,100,500,000 lived lives that of course got stuck in. As an example, you may have had a life as a Muslim, or as a Christian, as a proper, strict Catholic Christian, or as a Jehovah's Witness, or whatever. Something religious maybe. And after death, this part also enters a kind of reality segment in which this religion is lived. And then he hangs in there. That's it, yes, so to speak. So I always call them heaven and hell in quotation marks. And there, in a sky like that, they could be. And that's where they're trapped. And then it is important to get them out again in order to ultimately regain wholeness. Or, what do you think about exactly? For example, there are those who believe in the salvation of Jesus Christ. And they are trapped on one level, one astral level. They've been lying asleep for 1,000 years and don't wake up. Only when the image of Jesus that they know actually appears before them. This means that many spirit helpers and other beings are in the process of always changing into exactly the image and going to the one just as he saw it. Just as he believes Jesus looks to raise and redeem. And that is also a part that is trapped in sleeping. He sleeps in eternal sleep, and if Jesus does not come along as he knows him, he will sleep on there. Yes, it's similar to Sleeping Beauty. Only the right prince can wake up Sleeping Beauty. And so it is with religions. Then maybe you're waiting for Jesus, who will free you or others or an angel or something else from this emergency situation. You have to see what can free the part of the soul and how can you bring it back so that it comes back in its entirety. Exactly. And in order to bring the parts back, you either had to be aware of them, or of course there are also spiritual healers and spirit helpers who help you to free these parts and bring them back. We know a few very good ones that we can recommend to you. Exactly. But you can also do it independently by becoming a very good dreamer. That is, to achieve the art of lucid dreaming, for example, or the art of out-of-body experience, in order to search for these parts yourself and to defree. This is of course the do-it-yourself option. Exactly. For example, you can also talk to your soul parts if you are aware of someone who was hiding somewhere because they were so scared of something. Then you just go and talk to him, explain the situation to him and say that everything is fine and that everything is right and that everything makes sense. And that's how you can set him free. Just as an example, well, what's the next question? Exactly, our next question, is there always a tunnel? And what is the feeling when you want to or can get past the light? So first of all, I haven't seen a tunnel in either of my experiences. I only have one so everyone knows the tunnel and at the end of the tunnel there is a light. I was right in front of the light. But there was a tunnel, and it led into the black. And the feeling that was there just to go through the tunnel. And not in the light, was will and absolute certainty. This is the reincarnation trap. I want out of here, I want out of here. I pass it. It was simply will. So what? So it depends in advance on the intention, i.e. the reason or what you actually want inside your heart or what you wish for, I would say, because the wish then of course also opens the direction into which tunnel you go, want to go. You know that too. Perhaps some of you out-of-body experiences during out-of-body experience that you may also wish to visit someone in which you imagine the person. And the more you want it, the better it works. And I can very well imagine that it will be the same with the tunnel, that you imagine what you actually want, what you wish for, what you are still attached to, or attached to. And then the corresponding tunnel opens. Many have also asked us why. When one travels astrally, there is no tunnel. Why is there no light and no tunnel when one just leaves the body and travels astrally? But if you die. So during an out-of-body experience or an out-of-body experience isn't something you normally get into a tunnel of light, especially if you're a beginner. That only comes up later. By first changing from your astral body to a higher frequented body, the so-called mental body. And from there you get to know certain astral channels. So these are channels like wormholes that take you to certain astral planes. And there you can also perceive certain tunnels. One can also perceive tunnels of light through which the deceased passed. You can even see that in the mental body. And you can also walk through these tunnels. But you can't really go through it completely or since you still have a physical body on Earth, you are not considered deceased. The contact with the body is still there. It hasn't been severed and that's why you can actually go into a tunnel like that, but you can also get out again. Okay, you can also go through the tunnel to the middle astral plane and visit all the deceased who have just gone through the tunnel. You can still talk and talk to them and they are waiting there for their reincarnation. That brings us to the next question. What happens if you don't go into the light? Two options, either you decide to go into the black. That means pass the light with a firm will. Or you just go to the intermediate level. Or rather, you stay on the intermediate level, the so-called ghost belt, and you can really spend a lot of time there. That's where all the deceased end up. At least most end up there. And from the intermediate area. Of course you can stay longer there. It is up to you to decide who you want. You can stay there for years, decades or even 100 years. I wrote a story about it in my book. I met 3 soldiers there who were still wearing their uniforms from World War I. So you can imagine how long they've been walking around in the intermediate level in the twilight zone. Yes. You can give those from the intermediate level into the light or just try to leave the matrix.